Hello students, welcome to this English class. Today we are going to see a poem. The poem from the second unit. The second unit has Our Kashvarina Tree, which is written by Taru Dutt. What is the difference between a prose and a poem? Prose can be read by all, that is in simple style, but poetry cannot be easily read by everyone because the poetic diction is different from the prose. The poem has different rhyme scheme, rhyming words, figures of speech, everything. What is your idea about friendship? We can talk about friends and friendship hours together. Remember your childhood. Childhood friendship cannot be forgotten by anybody. Here also, the poet remembers her childhood. Poet is a common term for male as well as for female. Shall we go to the poem? Our Kashvarina Tree, written by Taru Dutt. First, let's see about the author, that is poet. See her picture. Taru Dutt was a Bengali poet. Where is Bengal? Yes, in India. Her lifespan was very short. It was from 1856 to 1877. She wrote in English and in French. Though she had involvement in Western life and culture, she loved the land of her birth, which is her land of birth, India. She remained thoroughly Indian. Her poems with the title Ancient Ballads and Legends of Hindustan is a well-known collection in 1882. Our Kashvarina Tree was included in her miscellaneous poems. See the picture of Kashvarina Tree? It is very familiar to us. Before going into the poem, I'll give you the gist of the poem. The theme of the poem is about lost friendships and lost childhood. Now, you are in 12th standard. Remember your good old days, that is in your 3rd or 4th standard. How will you be? We all used to play without food, without sleep, everything. We all used to play in our free time and during our holidays. Likewise, the poet here remembers her childhood with her friends. Here, for the poet, her childhood friends are no more. So, she was longing for those days. The poet remembers her play under the Kashvarina tree. The tree is a living symbol of their childhood friendship. So, she writes an ode to it. The poet has a view of the garden through the casement. The poet paints the serene picture of the morning. She had an emotional bond to the tree. The poet remembers the tree because of many happy memories of childhood days that are linked to it. They are the source of comfort and consolation to her. She expresses that the tree laments her loss of presence. She hopes that the tree will be remembered forever as the yew tree of Borrowdale, immortalized by Wordsworth, is still remembered. She immortalizes the tree for the sake of her loved ones by writing a poem for it. Now, have you got an idea about the poem? Shall we go to the poem? Okay. Now, take page number 52 in your textbooks. Have you all taken? Shall I read the poem? Listen carefully. Okay. Our Kashvarina Tree. Like a huge python,
winding
round and round the rugged trunk indented deep with scars up to its very summit near the stars. A creeper climbs in whose embraces bound no other tree could live. Here, what is a creeper? You know creeper. A creeper, like a huge python. What is a python? It's a big snake. The creeper, like a huge python, winds round and round the trunk of a tall and strong casuarina tree. The creeper doesn't stop up to the middle. The creeper climbs up to the trees, to the summit, that is to the peak. No other tree could live in the embraces of the creeper. If it is some other tree, it would not live. So this tree was strong. See the picture, how tall the tree is. But gallantly, the giant wears the scarf and flowers are hung in crimson clusters, all the boughs among whereon all day are gathered bird and bee. And oft at nights the garden overflows with one sweet song that seems to have no close, sung darkling from our tree while men repose. See the pictures. Crimson color is red color. The tree is full of flowers in all the boughs. So birds and bees, they used to sit all day long. See the picture again. The tree stands like a giant with the colorful scarf of flowers. The birds and the bees gather round the tree all day long. All nights one sweet song is heard with no end. Then come to the second stanza. When first my casement is wide open thrown at dawn, my eyes delighted on it rest. Sometimes, and most in winter, on its crest, a grey baboon sits statue-like alone, watching the sunrise while on lower boughs his puny offspring leap about and play. See the picture. The author, that is the poet, is watching through the window. Often in winter, the poet sees at down her easement that a grey baboon sits like a statue alone on the crest of the tree. What is a baboon? A monkey. His offspring jump about and play. What is meant by offspring? His younger ones. See the picture, how the baboon sits on the bough and his younger one jumping and playing. Come to the poetic line. And far and near, kokilas hail the day, and to their pastures wend our sleepy cows. And in the shadow on the broad tank cast by that hoar tree, so beautiful and vast, the water lilies spring like snow in mast. See the picture. The sleepy cows go to the pasture and the kokila's picture and how the water lilies sprung in the pond. Come to the third stanza. But not because of its magnificence dear is the casuarina to my soul. Beneath it we have played, though years may roll. O sweet companions,
loved with
love intense, for your sakes shall the tree be ever dear. Blent with your images, it shall arise in memory till the hot tears
blind
my eyes. Whatso the dirge-like murmur that I hear, like the sea breaking on a shingle beach. It is the tree's lament and eerie speech that haply to the unknown land may reach. The casuarina tree is very dear to the poet's heart, not because of its magnificence, but they have played under the tree. The poet remembers the sweet memories of the poet's happy childhood. She strongly believes that nature communicates with human beings. Do you agree with it? Yes. According to the poet and according to us, we should believe that nature communicates with human beings. Come to the next stanza. Unknown yet well known to the eye of faith. I have heard that wail far, far away, in distant lands, by many a sheltered bay, when slumbered in his cave, the water ray and the
waves
gently kiss the classic shore of France or Italy, beneath the moon, when earth lay tranced in a dreamless swoon. And every time the music rose, before mine inner vision rose the form sublime, thy form, O tree, as in my happy prime, I saw thee in my love native clime. The summary of this stanza is, the poet could communicate with the tree even when she was in a far off land, because she could hear the tree lamenting her absence. The poet is in France or Italy or some other country, but wherever she is, she could remember the Casuarina tree and her past reminiscence. The last stanza, therefore I fain would consecrate a lay unto thy honor, tree, beloved of those who now in blessed sleep for aye repose, dearer than life to me, alas, were they. Mayst thou be numbered when my days are done with deathless trees like those in Borrowdale, under whose awful branches lingered pale fear, trembling hope, and death, the skeleton that would thy beauty feign, oh, fain rehearse. May love defend thee from oblivion's curse. The summary of the last stanza is, the poet consecrates the tree's memory to her loved ones who are not alive. When the poet writes this poem, her friends were not alive. She immortalizes the tree through her poem. Like the poet Wordsworth, who sanctified the yew tree of Borrowdale in verse. Wordsworth also immortalizes the yew tree in his poem. Likewise, our poet Taru Dutt immortalizes the Casuarina tree through her poem. She expresses her wish that tree should be remembered out of love and not just because it cannot be forgotten. This is the summary of last stanza. Now, I hope you can read this poem. Now, take the first stanza again. For the first stanza, I'll tell you the rhyming words and alliterated words. For the remaining stanza, you have to find out. Take the first stanza. Like a huge python
winding
round and round, the rugged trunk indented deep with scars up to its very summit near the stars. A creeper climbs in whose embraces bound no other tree could live. Here, see the words round, bound, scars, stars. They are the rhyming words. What are rhyming words? The words end with same sound. Here, see these words. Round, bound, scars, stars, hung, among, close, repose. These are the rhyming words for the first stanza. You can find out rhyming words for the remaining stanzas. Take the first stanza again. Here, take the first line, like a huge python
winding
round and round. Here, the alliterated words are round and round. What are alliterated words? The words start with the same letter. Here, find out the alliterated words in the first line. Round and round starts with R. Any other line is like, yeah. Come to the fourth line. A creeper climbs in whose embraces bound. In this line, which are the alliterated words? See the words. Creeper, climbs. Both the words start with C. Likewise, you can find out the alliterated words for the remaining lines and remaining stanzas. Have you all understood the poem? Shall I ask you some questions? Yes. See this line from the first stanza, fourth line and fifth line. A creeper climbs in whose embraces bound no other tree could live. Have you all understood the line? A creeper climbs in whose embraces bound no other tree could live. Which tree is referred to in the above lines? Which tree is referred to in the above lines? Second question. Take down these questions and find out the answers. And give you in the next class. Second question. What is called the darkling? What is called the darkling? Have you all taken? Third question is, when does the bird sing her sweet song? When does the bird sing her sweet song? Shall I go to the next one? Fourth question, what do the puny offspring of the monkey do? What do the puny offspring of the monkey do? Next question. How will you feel when you visit your native village after some years? How will you feel when you visit your native village after some years? Once again, I tell you the summary. Listen carefully. These are the gist of the poem and main ideas of the poem. The Casuarina tree is tall and strong. The tree stands like a giant. Birds surround the garden and the sweet song of the bird is heard. The poet delighted to see the grey monkey sitting like a statue on the top of the tree. The cows grazing and the water lilies springing in the pond. The tree brings the memories of her happy childhood. The poet could communicate with the tree as she could hear the tree lamenting for her absence. She immortalizes the tree for the sake of her loved ones in the poem. Once again, I'll repeat the summary. The Casuarina tree is tall and strong. The tree stands like a giant. Birds surround the garden and the sweet song of the bird is heard. The poet delighted to see the grey monkey sitting like a statue on the top of the tree. The cows grazing and the water lilies springing in the pond. The tree brings the memories of her happy childhood. The poet could communicate with the tree as she could hear the tree lamenting for her absence. She immortalizes the tree for the sake of her loved ones in the poem. Have you all understood the poem? I hope you have understood the poem and come to the figures of speech. What are figures of speech? A poem has figures of speech which include simile, metaphor, alliteration, etc. For each and every poem, It has figures of speech. What are figures of speech? They are the poetic devices. I'll tell you two examples. You all know very well simile and metaphor. What is a simile? If the comparison comes openly in the line, in the poetic line, it is called simile. If the comparison is hidden in the line, it is called metaphor. Likewise, we have some more figures of speech. I'll give you some lines. You find out the figures of speech. Can you? Okay, take down the lines. First one is, the giant wears the scarf and flowers are hung. First one is, the giant wears the scarf and flowers are hung. Finished writing. Second one, like a huge python
winding
round and round. Like a huge python
winding
round and round. Shall I pass to the next one? Third one is, up to its very summit near the stars. Up to its very summit near the stars. Fourth one. Oh, sweet companion, love with love intense. Oh, sweet companion, love with love intense. Next one. Blent with your images, it shall arise. Blent with your images, it shall arise. And one more question for alliteration. I will give you the line. You have to find out the alliterated words. Are you ready? Take down the line. Where on all days are gathered bird and bee? Where on all days are gathered bird and bee? Finished? Pick out the alliterated words. Pick out the alliterated words from this line. I hope you have all understood the poem and you enjoyed the poem. Apostrophe. What is apostrophe? Have you heard this word earlier? Yes. But here there is a different meaning for this word. You think that apostrophe is a punctuation mark. It is not only a punctuation mark but also a literary device. Apostrophe is used by a writer to speak directly to someone who is absent or dead. He can also address an inanimate object. You can have a familiar example for apostrophe. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. Up above the world so high, like a diamond in the sky. This is a very famous rhyme you have read in your lower classes. Here, the writer or the poet speaks to the stars like speaking to a person. So, this is called apostrophe. Have you understood now? Yes. Metaphor. What is a metaphor? Metaphor involves a comparison between two relatively unlike things without the use of like or as. Example from the poem, Take the poem. In the first stanza, the giant wears the scarf and flowers are hung. Here, two things are compared without the comparing words like and as. So, this is called metaphor. Next figure of speech is personification. It is a figure of speech in which an inanimate object or abstraction is endowed with human qualities or abilities. Here we can have the example from our poem itself. Here the poem lends the tree itself human traits and abilities. What is the dirge-like murmur that I hear? One more line, that haply to the unknown land may reach. Next figure of speech is simile. This figure of speech you know very well, and you can identify this figure of speech also very well. What is a simile? A stated comparison that is usually formed with like or as. A stated comparison between two fundamentally dissimilar things that have certain qualities in common. So, we are using the comparing words like and as. See from our poem, the water lilies spring like snow enmassed. Here, the comparing word like comes. So, it is called simile. For your better understanding, I'll give the example from the poem. Take the first stanza and note the first line. Like the huge python winding round and round. The poem begins itself with the simile, that is one of the figures of speech. What is a simile? Open comparison. Like is the comparing word. So, come to the second part of the line, winding round and round. Alliteration is found here. What are the alliterated words? Round and round, because it begins with the same sound R. One more example from the first stanza. See the line, the giant wears the scarf and flowers are hung. Here, no comparing word is displayed. So, it is called metaphor because the comparison is there but it is hindering. So, it is called metaphor. I hope you can find out the other poetic devices in the poem.
இந்நிகழ்ச்சியை பற்றிய தங்களின் மேலான கருத்துக்களை கீழ்கண்ட முகவரிக்கு கடிதம் மூலமாகவோ மின்னஞ்சல் மூலமாகவோ குறுஞ்செய்தி மூலமாகவோ தெரியப்படுத்தலாம். அனுப்ப வேண்டிய முகவரி சிறப்பு அலுவலர் கல்வி தொலைக்காட்சி 8 தளம் அண்ணா நூற்றாண்டு நூலகம் காந்தி மண்டப சாலை கோட்டூர்புரம் சென்னை 685 தொலைபேசி எண் 7824001500